Now we look at members' rights. And the five most important ones are, number one, the right to have the Memorandum and Articles of Association observed, that means to enforce the constitution. Number two, the right to restrain ultra-virus, which means outside the powers, illegal acts by the company. Number three, the right to access to companies' records and certain information. Number four, the right to vote at general meetings. And number five, the right to be treated fairly. So let's look at the first one. They have the right to enforce the observance of the Memorandum and Articles of Association, now called the Constitution. Every member of the company has the right. This is because the Memorandum and Articles are a contract among the members and the company. So they can enforce this contract. If something is promised in the Memorandum Articles, they can be enforced. So in the case of Salmon and Quinn and Extance, the company's article said that certain contracts cannot be entered into without the agreement of both Salmon and Extance. Then the board wants to acquire certain premises and to rent out certain other premises, and Salmon disagrees. So what happened is that the members tried to override him by passing a resolution. And Salmon said, you can't override me because the article said that contracts cannot be entered into without both Salmon and Extance. And the court agreed. He wins, he gets his action to restrain the company because the article said, and you can't override. What they should have done was they should have changed the articles. But they just had to override him. And so long as the articles say that the contracts need his permission, they can't override. Second one, the right to restrain ultra-virus acts and illegal acts. Ultra-virus acts are acts which are outside the power of the company to do, right? Or something which is against the company's act. So if you see a company doing something which is illegal or out of powers, then the member can restrain it by going to court. Third one is that the member has right to access to information, so he can get hold of certain documents like register of members, register of directors, register of shareholding, and you don't have to pay. So you can get hold of all this to find out what the company is doing. But interesting, you can't get access to the directors' meetings. And you can do everything else. You get general meetings, minutes, you can get instruments, creating charges. You also cannot get access to accounting records, journals, and ledgers. Why not directors' meeting, journals, ledgers, vouchers? It could be because this will really interfere with the management of the company. So that may be the reason why these are out of the reach of the members. Fourth one, attendance at general meetings. So every member has a right to attend the general meeting and speak at the meeting and vote at the meeting. Unless you haven't paid for your shares, then, or you have shares which have no voting rights, then you don't count. Now, the number of votes each share carried is regulated by the Memorandum Articles, or rather Constitution. So it could be each share one vote, or you might have those kind of shares which are super shares and have extra votes. It depends on what is stated in the Constitution. And each member can vote as what he likes. He doesn't have to take care of the interests of the company. It's his own personal interest. Yeah? Unless they're trying to alter the articles, that's a different case. Then they must vote for the benefit of the company as a whole. But otherwise, every member for himself or herself. And finally, they have the right to be treated fairly. Now, if it is found that any member is being treated unfairly, this is very important. This section is a very important section, section 216, where the minority is being oppressed. So refer to the notes. You will really want to refer to the notes for this. Members' rights. Okay. These are all here, everything that I've mentioned so far. The right to be treated fairly is a very important right, because usually the usual way in which a company makes decisions is through majority vote. But that means that the minority could get squeezed out. So if the company is being run in a way that the minority is suffering, and let's go back to the slides on this. So this is important. Let's say the company's business is being carried out in a way that's oppressive to one or more members. or the directors are exercising their power in a way that's oppressive, or they're disregarding the interests of the minority. And this is pretty serious. They have to be really oppressive or disregarding, or they're going to do something which is going to discriminate against some members of the company, or is against them, prejudicial meaning against them. Then you may apply to the court under section 216 of the Companies Act. And the court is going to interfere if they see there's a departure from a standard of fair dealing and fair play. So if you're being really unfair in how you treat the minority, and the company that the majority was aware that the minority is going to suffer, but they just ignore, they deliberately decide to push aside, or they're discriminating in a way that cannot be because of the benefit of the company, they just want to be unfair, or they're against the articles, then the court will say, hey, this is oppressive, we can't let it happen. And this is under section 216 of the Companies Act. If the court agrees that there has been oppressive behavior, the court will say, we might cancel any transaction, prohibit any transaction, prohibit any resolution. The court might say, we'll regulate how the company runs in the future. The court might say, we allow the minority to sue, because remember, not everybody gets to vote. They're going to give the minority the power to sue, or they might order the company to put the majority to purchase the shares of the minority so that they can be bought out and released. Or in the final worst case, wind up the whole company. Everything's over. So you can see how powerful section 216 is if the minority is being oppressed. But to be oppressed, you must really be very, very unfair behavior. So it must be a dominant power. So this is some of the cases. It must be something like oppression or disregard, that you really ignore how the interests are. But let's look at the last sentence on this group. Disagreements about policy are not oppression, because the fact is that many times minority will disagree with majority. This disagreement alone will not trigger section 216. It has to be really, really oppressive or disregarding, unfair. Then section 216 can come in, and all those powerful acts which you saw previously. That's why it says that not every breach of company's articles will invoke section 216. This is the case of Kumar Library. And it must really affect the member in its capacity as a member. So if it's just something which is still, you don't really feel that you got what you wanted, too bad. It's only the really, really serious thing that will trigger off section 216. And if it's over already, then don't come and complain, because you must be complaining about something which is happening right now. Then you get relief. So sometimes it's because the dominant members pursue a course of conduct which will give themselves a benefit. Let's say the majority do something which they're going to get money out of it, and the minority is not going to get money. That means they're doing something will advance their own interests. In the case of Bright Pine Mills. Or they might run the company as if it's their own, and they buy this and buy that, you know, and they disregard the interests of the minority who's not getting any of these benefits. That's also section 216. And if they actually try to take over a member's property, that's really serious. That's amounting to unfair treatment. Or if they exclude somebody from management of the company, even though they previously agreed, that's also unfair treatment. So if you're being unfairly treated, please seek relief expeditiously, soon, quickly, go and get relief under section 216. Don't sit around, otherwise the court's going to doubt you. The section 216 powers under 216A allow the member to sue on behalf of the company. And that's where the court allows the member to sue, even though the basic rule would be that company and members are different. Remember Foss and Harbottle? This was quite long earlier in the semester. But otherwise, only the company itself can sue. But if you have applied under section 216A, any member who is given the power under 216A can sue. So this applies only to companies that are Singapore incorporated and not listed on the exchange. It means they are private. So this one, you must actually give notice to the company directors because you're going to be overriding them. And you must explain to the court that it's in the interest of the companies that you get this power to sue, because normally you're not supposed to have this power. And that as you, the member who wants this action, you are doing it in good faith. Huh? So there are some recent changes. And that brings us to the end of the e-learning. Please answer the simple questions you will find on the little quiz, and you'll be marked present for this day. Thank you.